I'm short, I cannot stand behind this thing. Yes, I'm Elena. Hi, everyone. And we're going to come back to women's health, because I will talk about the cervix project. The cervix is the lower part of the uterus, and it's a doorkeeper for the uterus. It decides what comes into the uterus and what can go out. So, for example, pathogens that are in the vagina are supposed to stay out of the uterus so that the uterus doesn't get infected. But on a few days in a month, sperm is allowed to pass through. And while the cervix prevents infections of the uterus, it can be infected itself. For example, with the human papilloma virus. And 80% of sexually active women get an infection at least once in their lifetime. So we really need models so that we understand better the mechanism of infections and also the consequences of infections with HPV, which can be cervical cancer. So if you have a closer look at the cervical area where most cervical cancers arise, which is here in the ectocervix, we can see that this is a squamous epithelium that stratifies. So we have basal cells that proliferate and then move towards the apical side of the epithelium and then differentiate. And when HPV infects the basal cells, they kind of prevent this differentiation process and keep them in a proliferative state. So with a persistent HPV infection, the epithelium differentiates less and less until the whole epithelium is made fully of proliferating cells. And when the HPV infection is still not cleared, this can then lead to cervical cancer, which is when these cells invade into the stroma underneath. So what I'm interested in is having three models. So the healthy model, to understand the mechanisms of infection, and then two disease models, obviously, because we want treatments. And we started this project with the development of a platform. So we designed and fabricated the platform, and at the same time, we also looked into the biology, because we wanted to make sure that we actually have cervical cells that we can then put into the chip. We then started into with the engineering of the three models, and we had to find readouts so that we can evaluate our tissue. And some readouts are pretty straightforward, like effluent analysis, and others were quite challenging because I wanted to get tissue sections from the chip, because in the clinic that is still the standard method how you would look at cervical tissue. And with that, we kind of went back to the microfabrication, because we had to adapt our chip so that we are really able to get sections from our tissue there. I will not talk a lot about how we fabricate the chip, just a few key facts. It's a PDMS-free chip. We use microstructuring methods like hot embossing and laser cutting, and then we thermally fuse all these layers together so that we get a chip that looks a little bit like that. So more in detail, we have a size of a microscopic slide, which makes it a little bit convenient for use with microscopes. We have two independent systems, so a channel here and a channel here, and each of these this channel supplies nutrients to four separate tissue wells. And each tissue well looks a little bit like a small trans well, so we have a tissue chamber that is separated by a membrane from the channel underneath. We added a reservoir layer on top, because that gives us some flexibility on how we culture our tissue in the well, because sometimes we want to keep it submersed and sometimes we want to have an airlift, which means the tissue grows at the interface between air and liquid. So I started talking about biology already, so let's go here. For the cells, we use human ex vivo tissue that we then split into different areas. We start with the epithelium that we use to isolate keratinocytes. From the subepithelial stroma, we isolate fibroblasts, and then from the connective tissue, we can then isolate endothelial cells. And we always kept a little piece of this tissue so that we can establish a whole characterization panel, this here on the left, so that we can later compare our tissue to what we actually get from the clinic. And now that we have the cells, we can put them in the chip, and we start with the fibroblasts. We seed the fibroblasts in a hydrogel, and we use a dextran hydrogel that is cross-linked with a hyaluronic acid cross-linker, which is cell-degradable. So we have a hydrogel that allows for remodeling. We see the keratinocytes on top on the next day, and then we keep them a few days to equilibrate in the co-culture. next, we remove the liquid from the top to induce the differentiation and start the perfusion from the channel. We do that for a few days, and then we're ready to look at our system. And here is when we also can remove our tissue to apply to, as I said, sectioning. But this is another advantage, because we have four wells in one channel. We can now take one well to do sectioning, one well for analysis of viability and whatsoever. Like, we have now a way to have different readout methods on the same system. And this is how the healthy model looked like. We have an epithelium on top, and then when we look in the Z stacks, we can see that the fibroblasts are distributed in 3D in the hydrogel, and they elongate a little bit as you would expect from fibroblasts. We were then interested if the epithelium stays viable over the whole differentiation process, and it seems like they are doing pretty fine after the 2 weeks. And most importantly, we can see different markers for basal cells and also for differentiated keratinocytes. So now we have a chip that has two advantages. The one is that the hydrogel doesn't shrink. That's the problem with collagen. And the second is that cervical keratinocytes actually accept this hydrogel. And that was quite a challenge, because these are diva cells. They don't like every hydrogel. We were now interested into modeling what happens if HPV infects a cell and then the cells are not able to differentiate into a full epithelium. So for that, we used a very similar setup, but exchanged the healthy keratinocytes with a keratinocyte cell line that has an HPV16, the most abundant genotype, integrated into the genome. And with that, we can see that the epithelium gets pretty thick and non-differentiated, as we would expect it in a SYN3 model. And also, we can confirm that these cells are proliferative throughout the whole epithelium, and that they lose the E-cadherin signal. That's also a hallmark of this disease state. And I'm pretty excited about this disease model, because I feel like it's very often overlooked. Because patients with a SYN3, they don't have a treatment. What happens is they remove the cervix. That's it. So this is a disease that is not very severe. But in order to prevent any patients to progress to a cervical cancer, the cervix is removed. So now we have collaborators who have really nice ideas on how we could treat it. And this is what we're going to do next. But for me, because I model the tissues, for me the next step was, what do we do if these cells start invading, so we have a cancer model? Here is a histology section from the clinic. We have here the cancerous nest, so the epithelial cells that invaded into the stroma. And we tried to emulate this 3D architecture by making little cancer spheroids and then cold culturing them with healthy fibroblasts. And that worked quite well. We used the dextran hydrogel again with a higher stiffness to have more the cancer TME feeling, so higher stiffness. And after 2 weeks, we can see that the spheroids are still there, works quite nicely, they are proliferative, and in white, there are the fibroblasts in between them. And now we were wondering, do the fibroblasts matter? Because for the healthy model, we know the keratinocytes really love to have their fibroblast bodies close by. And that's quite similar now with the cancer model, because when we remove the fibroblasts, the spheroids are much smaller compared to the co-culture. And then after 2 weeks, we see with the proliferation marker that this is also true for at later stages, that really the fibroblasts induce the proliferation of the cancer spheroids. Now, there is another cell type that I'm really excited about that's part of the tumor microenvironment, and these are the neutrophils. These are not only the most abundant cells, but they have a really cool way of killing, which is netosis. Neutrophils can decondense their DNA and mix it with proteins that they usually store in little granules, and they mix this toxic and sticky substance and extrude it into the extracellular space. And they do that because they can then trap and also kill pathogens. And that looks super cool. And it's a Spider-Man move that got me really excited until I learned that NETs are involved in everything that has to do with cancer, and involved mainly not in a good way. Just to give you two examples, these NETs can actually shield solid tumors from other immune cells. So they play a role in immune surveillance, and also in the blood vessel, they can not only trap pathogens, they can trap circulating tumor cells, press them against the wall, and help metastasize into distant sites. So So these are little monsters that I definitely had to add to my chip. But first, some groundwork. We had to find a media that prevents spontaneous netosis, but we still have to be able to induce netosis with a commonly used molecule. And this media, of course, has to be compatible with our cervical cells. We found that, and we also established a panel with published proteins so that we can visually distinguish between a neutrophil that has undergone netosis and not. So then we were ready to perfuse neutrophils of nice colleagues that I have in the channel and then see if they do actually migrate into the tissue. And you can see here there are quite a few neutrophils in yellow stuck to the membrane because I perfuse them in the channel. But if you do find their way and migrate through the membrane into the tissue with the microtumors and the fibroblasts. And with that we were ready to induce netosis. And that worked quite nicely. So here is an image when we induce netosis of neutrophils that are in the tissue. And you can see here is an early marker and this smear is what they really extrude outside. And because most neutrophils are in the channel we get quite large structure of these nets. And this is really exciting because now we can start to combine models. We can have a cancer model in the first wells and downstream a healthy model and see that if we induce netosis in the channel, do we see more metastasis into the healthy tissue? That's going to be next. But now I want to go back to the model without any immune cells. Because what do you do with cancer? You kind of treat it, right? And we looked into cisplatin, which is the standard care for cervical cancer patients, and they get an infusion for an hour, so it increases in the serum and then it drops pretty quickly, and we try to emulate this dynamic in the serum as well as just keep a very low dose. And we did that after 5 days. We generated the tissue, we treated our tissue for 24 hours, and then we kept culturing them and treated them again and again. Because that's what patients do. They don't receive it once. They receive it multiple times on a weekly basis. And in the beginning, we don't see really effects. But after the second and the third treatment, we do see that we have an LDH release, so the cells are dying. And we see it also in the tunnel staining. So our model does respond to very, very low levels of cisplatin that we would really find in patient serum. And with that, I would like to sum up. So we have a platform that allows us to generate tissue and to get sections from it. We can isolate 3 cell types from a human ex vivo tissue. We can generate 3 models that are complex and with several cells that talk to each other. We can induce netosis. We have neutrophils that migrate into the cancerous tissue because they're recruited. And last but not least, we see a drug response with our tumor model at very low concentrations. And with that, I would like to thank Peter and the whole lab. I want to thank our collaborators, the donors, and the organizers for letting me present my data here. And I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you. That was very exciting and very stimulating and cool. I have 2 quick questions. One, have you exposed it to any hormones to see if you get like mucin secretion or different cornification profiles? And then secondly, have you looked at the fibroblasts with the cancer cells to see if they're more cancer associated? Thanks.
Okay, so 2 questions. The first one was whether we added hormones and whether this has an effect on mucin. My colleague, she works on the healthy model for infection studies and she looked into mucin, so they do produce it. That's the one question. The other one was with the hormones. To be honest, yes, I did add it, but my readout methods did not work yet. So I unfortunately cannot tell. But yeah, I would expect that the cervical epithelium would get thicker because that is a very responsive tissue. Yeah. And the next question was, I love that. Yeah, cancer-associated fibroblasts. I started looking into that because I was wondering, because I use healthy fibroblasts, how long do I have to culture them and will they react? So I started adding a few markers, but this is still ongoing, so I can't tell yet.
Have just an extra minute. We have been trying to culture the endocervix, which is this whole other ball of wax, and there's bleed, you know, of course it's not like a bright shiny mm-hmm. line between the two. When you do your cervical cell isolations, can you tell us how easy or hard it is to get the cells that you want to make your tissue? Because we do endometrium all the time and it's not that bad, but the endocervix was a pain in the neck, and I haven't put a lot of effort into it, but what is the ectocervix like in terms of the isolation and getting enough cells and all of that?
It was difficult in the beginning, but I think now we're pretty good with the ectocervical cells and as well with the endocervix. I mean, I didn't talk about endocervix. But we can also isolate endocervix because a lot of infections are actually, like chlamydia and gonorrhea, they're more
they
infected.
They go through the upper FGT. Yeah, because I had a little project with somebody at MGH on this, and it was just getting an expansion of the endocervical cells. Like, we tried to do it in organoids, we just maybe didn't try hard enough. And because the endocervix you have to expand as organoids, do you have to expand yours as organoids, the ectocervix?
No, definitely. The ectocervix is fine. No,
yeah, because it's like keratin.
Yeah. No, you don't need it. But yeah, for the endocervical cells, the isolation is quite nice, but the subcultivation is challenging for the endocervical keratinocytes.
Yeah,
but ectocervix is pretty straightforward for that.
Okay. Indulging me on a little technical point. All right, if there's no more questions, I think we can go on to the last talk.